Hello and welcome to the 31st edition of Office Hours presented by Something Digital. This is the Valentine's Day edition. So, I mean,
aww.
31, it's obvious, you know, you go to Baskin Robbins, go to 31, you pick up some ice cream and you give it to your Valentine. Of course, the first edition. Of course.
Oh my gosh,
it's what we do.
31 episodes. That's one a day for a month.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, that's or true. 28.
February.
February, yeah. Plus three that are bonus episodes.
Yeah.
I have no idea. I had nothing to lend to that.
The bonus fries, if you will.
So the two handsome gentlemen you guys are hearing right now are Mr. Philip Jackson.
Hey!
And Senor Brian Lang.
What's up? both of us are sick.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
There's going to be an audio quality issue.
Sniffling. I might just like turn off my camera at some point. And...
A little coughing in the middle.
Yeah. It's love does crazy things.
Yeah, at least you guys get to share your sickness with your loved ones today.
That's awesome. All right, Tony, what do you have for us today?
All right, so like I said, today is a Valentine's Day edition. So today we're going to be talking about things that we love. Oh. But first, we're going to talk a little bit about our Valentine's Day blog, which is currently on our website. Philip, tell us about our Valentine's Day blog.
Okay. I've got deja vu. I feel like I might have covered this somewhere at some point elsewhere, but
you talked a little bit about it on the last episode.
Yeah.
But I feel like it was pretty high level and everybody needs a little refresher.
Okay. So, the first thing that I think everybody needs to do is you got to go over to somethingdigital.com/blog. I know it's like egregious self-promotion, but honestly, I don't write everything that's there. A lot of our team contributes to the blog. And we have some killer stuff happening right now. So here,
this is Office Hours presented by Something Digital. I'm pretty sure what we're doing here is
it is all egregious self promotion.
Yeah.
Here, I'm going to
show you. You're on brand.
This is our blog, and there's a couple things happening. So we just wrote a blog about five reasons that you want to jump on the PWA bandwagon. And in just 2 days' time, speaking of things we love, PWAs, things we love.
I was just going to ask, do we love PWAs?
We love PWAs. But in 2 days' time, 2 days from now, we're going to have a blog that's five reasons to wait to not do PWA yet. So we have a, fair and balanced at the Something Digital Network.
Stop it.
If you scroll down a little
That's
bit,
the second time today you've made a reference where
I can't help it. So if you scroll down a little bit, you'll also see that we have a special 20th anniversary post. It's 20 years that we celebrate that Something Digital has been in business, 20 awesome years. And we were talking a little bit about the retrospective of the past 20 years from Women in Tech, and that's written by our Women in Tech team at Something Digital. But let's go down to the Valentine's. Oh, I think I passed it. Let's go down to the Valentine's post because that's really what we're supposed to be talking about right now. Acquire your Valentine's customer now. I'll pop back out of this, but I just wanted to remind everybody. So this is the main takeaway. When you're acquiring a customer, when you're spending money to acquire a customer this time of year, you're not acquiring one customer. Go read this blog. I'm not going to read it to you. But the biggest takeaway that you should be focused on in this season or any gifting season, Mother's Day, Father's Day, Valentine's Day is right at the beginning of, in North America, of the next two gifting holidays. And then we get into things like, wedding season, then we get into things like engagement season. And so gifting holidays are super important, and Valentine's Day is the first one of the year. And if you can get out of the mindset of your PPC monthly budget spend and stop thinking about paid search or traffic acquisition as a budget and start thinking of it less around I'm going to spend X amount per month, and start thinking of it more around, I need to spend X amount per customer acquisition and track that directly, then I think you'll have a much more balanced approach to what your spend truly should be, in that you'll spend more around times like Valentine's Day, where it costs more money to acquire a customer because you have more people that are spending more on digital marketing around this time of year, but you acquire more customers in the process, because you're not only acquiring the customer who's buying, which is the gift giver, but you're potentially acquiring the business of the gift recipient, and then anyone that they may give to later on as well, and so on and so on. And so in that experience, you also are learning more about these people and more about customers at the same time. So you want to have that spend goes to funnel every other part of your business. So if you can get them to complete some sort of a micro goal while they're on your site, that means sign up for Facebook Messenger for product updates and shipment notifications, or give me your phone number so I can send you text messages, or opt into our email so I can send you newsletters. That way, all future engagement from them doesn't have to come back through paid search again. Then you've acquired them once, and now they're your customer forever, and you can touch them again for free in the future. So stop thinking of it as my cost, my acquisition cost per customer. We're all adults here.
Yeah, I mean, it's Valentine's Day.
It is Valentine's Day. So your acquisition cost per customer is actually, it's a bargain this time of year. If you're getting 3 for 1, but you're paying two times more for it, you're actually saving a third on all three. My math's probably wrong, but I think you get the gist of it. So that's kind of what we're looking for. And then you want to create a whole engagement campaign. If you do acquire a customer that's brand new at Valentine's Day, you want to create an engagement campaign that speaks to the way that they can give that same awesome experience they just had with your brand at Mother's Day and Father's Day too. And you know what you should do? Try to get them to purchase that now. Don't wait till May. Don't wait till June. Get them back in your funnel right away and sort of capitalize on their good feeling now. I think they're more likely to spend more now with you and get, you know, have it all taken care of and get that out of the way. And then by the time May and June roll around, maybe you say, hey, why don't you add X to your order? You already bought it. We'll ship this other thing along with it, or get one for yourself. Lots of ways to build up on this type of season. So a lot in this blog.
Well, here's some additional data from NRF. This is a huge holiday. And while the number of people that are participating in celebrating Valentine's Day is going down, it's happening every year. The amount that the people that are participating is going up at a much, much faster pace. And so, it's projected that there's going to be $20.7 billion spent on Valentine's Day this year, which would be a record spend. And that's at an average of $162 in spending per person that participate. The very, very interesting thing and the funny thing that I caught here was that while men spend significantly more, average of $339 on Valentine's Day. Women spend it on average $64. And men expect that their partners are going to spend more than that on them. They expect they're going to spend $211 on them. Interesting little tidbit there. I wonder if there's a way to capitalize on that. Do a whole campaign around spending more on men.
That's there's a ton of advertising on like what your wife or what your girlfriend expects from a guy, but it seems like there's no advertising on the opposite, you know, unless I'm missing something, right? Like every engagement ring commercial you see is the message is, this is what your girlfriend is expecting when you propose to her.
Right.
So you're like what you're saying, Brian, makes sense. And it seems like there's a gap there to a certain
extent. Well, I think the gap actually could be covered in that NPR just did a story that I heard last night about the rise of Galentine's Day, which was actually created on Parks and Rec in 2008. Right. And so creating these sort of, you know, novel fake holidays, and it happens before Valentine's Day. It's not a consolation prize. It's the main event, right? Valentine's Day is the runner-up to Galentine's Day. So this idea is that you could create marketing campaigns that appeal to women that aren't really just giving to men. It could be giving to girlfriends. It could be like, there's other ways to engage people that, you know, aren't just about relationship purchases, or I should say like a significant other, a romantic relationship purchase. You could do it, you know, for friends, for kids, for like, you can enable that commerce experience with just about anybody if you do it in a thoughtful way. Yeah.
I feel like I want to work in as many Parks and Rec jokes as I can now, but I'll refrain.
I'm interested in who these men are that are expecting $211 in gifts. That's what I expect more from my wife.
Now that makes me want to expect more.
Yeah, well. Exactly.
It's like, oh, other guys are expecting more. I should expect more too.
I'm actually sitting here and my wife made little heart-shaped cupcakes right next to me right here. How much does a box of chocolate cake cost? Not $211.
Oh man, you're in such trouble now.
Oh, this is,
she don't
it's
worry.
Live. This is live on Facebook, man.
It is actually. It's thing that there's only three people who watch this show, and it's the three of us.
She doesn't tune into this particular program.
Okay, so speaking of heart shaped cupcakes and things that everybody loves, I thought we would talk about things we all love.
Yeah.
I wrote down two, but I don't see any from you two. So I'll take the first shot, and then I'll let you guys get your acts together. Okay, everybody knows I love ADA compliance, right? You know that. Terrible segue. I love ADA compliance. It's been opaque for a long time. Whether or not you are whatever compliant means. I could talk about what that even means because it's no such thing as compliance. Conformity is probably the right word we're looking for. But anyway, also ADA is not the word we use, but that's a whole other ball of wax. We have a partner that we are starting to work with that we really, really like. And in the interest of, you know, Something Digital has always been the company that, you know, shares what it learns. And because this is a widely available tool, we wanted to point it out to everybody. So there's a partner in the ecosystem called SiteImprove, who you may have heard of, who I believe we met at ETAIL West last year. Right, Brian?
Yes.
That sounds correct.
Yes.
So SiteImprove has a tool that specifically focuses on things that are like compliance monitoring, things like brand compliance or SEO. They do accessibility, data security. They've got some, you know, some GDPR type, you know, soft GDPR checks. But one of the things about compliance is it's an ongoing management exercise in your business. You have to create sort of a program in your business to always be managing a level of compliance. And ADA is, you know, one of those many facets. SiteImprove has this really nifty browser tool that, like, that's all that it does is it sort of checks the accessibility of your website. So if you don't necessarily just go and sign up for SiteImprove directly, and let's say that you don't buy their tool or you don't subscribe to their program, and you just wanted to use their browser plugin to check the accessibility of your website and to find areas that might need improvement on an accessibility basis, you could do that because they have this really cool tool. And I'm going to demonstrate it right now with some more egregious self-promotion on a website that is not accessible. this is our podcast called Future Commerce.
Can I just point out how epic the new logo is?
Oh, thank you.
I love that.
Really appreciate that. we did this on purpose. This is just so that you could give us, so we could work in content about our rebrand on future commerce. But anyway,
this is like Inception. This is a podcast within a podcast.
It is a podcast. We're three layers down, three levels. So there's this site improve accessibility checker. Okay. So we click this button and then it's going to tell me, you know, thank you for using it. You're not supposed to use it on sites that are live. And then I click this skip form button. And then, which is okay. And then I go back and now I'm going to check to see what my accessibility score is for this site. And it turns out I can sort of filter this into different areas. Now, if you want to find out more about what conformance level means for like AAA, AAA, you can click this handy dandy button that they have, which will give you a brief description. If you want even more, head on over to somethingdigital.com/blog, download our two accessibility ebooks that we wrote that's specifically all about that sort of stuff. But let's dig into a little bit on, you know, on futurecommerce.fm about the kinds of things that are difficult to, that you wouldn't otherwise know about your lack of accessibility on a website like this. So I've clicked AA as my conformance level and I want to look at, you know, just errors. So I'm going to uncheck all this stuff. So it actually has like role responsibilities that it highlights. Like, can I as a copy editor fix this thing on the website, or do I have to be a, you know, a developer to do it? And so each of these responsibilities you could, you know, sort of choose by role and responsibility. So let's say, you know, you wanted to filter out a couple things. So as a developer, I may only be able to, as a developer, I can make changes specifically to make my site have a little more contrast. So, you know, if I wanted to make a change to the page and that, you know, was around contrast, my page title of this H1 text, this header text, is not contrasting enough with the background color for it to be accessible. And so each of these little pieces is like, I can actually click in and find where on the page the issue is. And then I can make meaningful changes, to them to make it more accessible. Now this is their browser plugin and their suite, of tools goes way deeper when you actually subscribe to the software. And I believe that this, I mean, this is the future, if you will. This is like, you need this. And even if you never talk to Something Digital or engage us to do accessibility work for you ever, like this is something you need to be doing for your own brand period anyway, because you can manage a lot of this stuff on your own. Now, you do still need a partner sometimes to tell you what's material and what's not. And in many cases, you can't just easily use a checker to find out whether you're compliant, but this is a wonderful first start. And it gets you started today rather than waiting to have a bunch of conversations and go through contracting. You could begin a program about accessibility today in your organization by using a tool like this that's freely available. So things we love.
So I have a question about this.
Sure.
So you talk about this pretty often and about how WCAG or WCAG or whatever we call it, compliance is not set in stone, but instead it's a guideline. Like I was wondering, do you know, or can you show a site that you know of that is AAA compliant? Do you know of one that is?
Yeah.
Because I know, like, for example, the SD Accelerator, another shameless promotion, is out of the box, single A compliant, right?
Right. So that's correct. Yeah. There's definitely a, There are certain guidelines that, you know, AA has a certain level of conformity or compliance that mm-hmm. that have some mandates that are pretty astringent that sort of limit the type of access or functionality that sort of limit the sort of things that you can do with ease on a website. AAA is really meant for public access, for use of large publicly accessed websites. I'll give you a good example of I'll give you a good example of a site that should be AAA compliant, which would be this?
The ADA compliance website, I would hope.
you've got me. All right, here, I'll share it. For as smart as I think I am, I can't figure out how to share stuff very easily. Here we go. So if I click our handy dandy button for Site Improve, ideally the it's going to take a little while to process, I think. Ideally, they only had 16 issues on. they're not 100% either, and so neither are you, neither am I. For certain websites, I guess the WCAG website is not quite up to snuff. That's okay. Let's do one that's like National Weather Service. That's a government website. That should be one that it's just ugly enough that you kind of might expect that it would be fully ADA compliant. Let's check it.
Let's also confirm that ADA compliance does not necessarily mean ugly.
Yeah. Okay. No, that's true. That's true. AAA compliance is severely limiting. And in many cases, I think the things that here that you would be, right off the bat, you might say are pretty concerning are things like this text size. And, it looks like they have
another reviews, text right? size is way too small and it's close together.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of
issues on weather.gov. If I went to whitehouse.gov, what do you think whitehouse.gov scores at? Let's see.
No comment.
let's go. We're going to hit the button. By the way, I have never had so much fun as I'm having right now on office hours. Wow. This one needs a little help too. But it's not hundreds of issues. I think the point that we might want to be making here is that it's always a work in progress. Attaining, it's like Google page speed, right? Everyone wants to be 100 on their Lighthouse score. But if you got to 100 on Lighthouse score, you probably put in so much work and effort that you've forgotten other things along the way that are also material and important. What is really important is not to focus on just getting one thing to completion. It's that you have a culture in the organization to constantly make this part of the way you develop content, the way that you develop your website, and that you're constantly paying attention to it.
Great.
And if you out there know of a site that is 100% ADA or accessibility accessible, 100% accessible at a AA level, I'd love to see it. Show me.
Yeah. Tweet at Phil Winkle on Twitter. all right. That was great. You were having the time of your life and I was having the time of my life. We were all having the time of our lives. It was great.
Is this where we play Patrick Swayze? Can I run at you? Like I'm a baby. Nobody puts baby in the corner.
It's Valentine's Day. That's a great movie to watch on Valentine's Day. Definitely check Dirty that Dancing. One out. Dirty Dancing.
Brian, have you seen Dirty Dancing?
It's been a while. It's been a long while. Dirty.
Great point. Always a work in progress. Thanks. Thanks, Chase. Appreciate that. Brian, what do you love?
So here's one that I've been really digging lately. Afterpay. There are a lot of services out there that do sort of the buy now, pay later model. What I'm really excited about regarding Afterpay in particular is that their model has no fees. It's zero interest. There's no credit check for consumers. And actually, let me explain the model first. So if you haven't heard of Afterpay or of Bread or of Affirm or of any of these tools, then this will be really good information for you as a retailer. They're a tool where essentially someone can come and check out with this tool. And then the company, any one of these companies, will take on the payment and the risk for that payment and allow consumers, your customers, to be able to make multiple payments. Some of them give more flexibility than others about how they structure that payment fee or that payment fee is laid out. And then they immediately pay you as the merchants. So they take on the risk for the payment and you get the money right away. And there's no credit cards necessary. This has been a big trend in payment technology. There are a lot of these different providers out there. And I think Affirm has done a really good job of like being first to market, or maybe not first to market, but one of the early ones to market and making it really, really easy for people to do this. But Afterpay is super exciting to me because almost all of these other providers require some sort of a credit check, which means you have to put in your social security number. They also typically have fees for the end customer. What I like about Afterpay is no credit check and no fees unless they're late on payments. And they do that with some crazy back-end technology, how they allow someone to use this system. They still have to go through the Afterpay like stamp of approval before they'll let someone use this method of payment, but it's not the same thing as a credit check. And so you as a merchant, this is for, if you have high value items that you're selling on your site, this is a huge benefit to you because people that are like the process of paying in installments are going to be able to, you know, do this without using their credit card and be able to get approved on the spot for this and not have any fees associated with it. So it definitely is a conversion rate optimization booster. And I think just provides your customers with a lot more flexibility in how they want to make the payment at no risk to you as the merchant. And there are fees associated for you, but you are going to pay a fee to have your credit cards processed anyway. So to me, it's a no-brainer to have a service like this on your site if you have, if you're the right model of merchant and you have those high-value items.
Yeah, agreed. And actually, one of our clients is doing something similar to this. I don't know if this is something that we can or should call out by, you know, by name, but you know, it's a client that we love to work with and doing something similar on their own site using their own technology.
Right. And that's on their own site, which I love. That's another great point to bring up. Yeah. We should probably get their permission before we start.
Right.
I don't think we've actually launched with them yet.
No, we haven't.
We'll have to come back to that in the future, but we are working with someone really cool that's built a site that sells an insane amount of product and has a very similar model, which I think is awesome.
Have either of you used that when used one of these applications when purchasing?
Yes. And I'm doing it right now because I just realized that Goat, the shoe retailer, uses Afterpay. And now
folks gonna buy.
I'm gonna buy the hypest sneakers you've ever seen in your life.
I want to say I just bought some sneakers on StockX today, and I want to say they use Affirm.
I think they do. Yeah. I think they do.
I didn't use it. I didn't use Affirm, so you know, bad pitch by me. But I noticed it when I was on the site, and it was interesting. This is actually something that I've never used before. You know, we had Ben Presley in the Something Digital office a few months ago, and he came in to talk to us a little bit about Afterpay. And the interesting point that he brought up was millennials and credit, and how he brought up that it was what, like 13% or something like that of millennials don't currently have a credit card. So this was their way of pitching to like millennials, like you don't have to do a credit check in order to make payments on something, which was interesting to me.
They're being used by a lot of really interesting brands. Revolve, who's actually speaking at Shop Talk, which we're going to be at coming up. Revolve uses Afterpay. Urban Outfitters uses Afterpay. Steve Madden, Nasty Gal, Forever 21, Sunglass Hut. It's being used actively by a lot of brands that you're going to know. It is new, relatively new technology here in the States because it was actually started in Australia. But this is something that, you know, I think a lot of merchants are going to start taking advantage of quickly here in the US.
If, If I could just give one little piece of advice about Afterpay and services like it, which don't require a credit pull, they are doing this with really interesting partner technologies that basically create a different type of a trust score for you based on things like date of birth, public record, full legal name, and they are partnered with some incredible data stores like LexisNexis and some others, and they create a score based on, you know, on demand, based on your, you know, based on the information they can find out about you, you know, just in time at the time of the credit request. So it's a different way of sort of calculating credit worthiness without actually checking your public credit history. That would be, you know, one of the issuing the credit beacon score providers in the United States. It's really, really interesting. I think we're going to see a lot more of this.
Love it.
Yeah, I would agree.
Philip, before we move on, what shoes are you buying?
I am buying the Off-White Air Jordan Retro High OG UNCs, which are have been some what I would say grails of mine for some time.
Yeah, are you actually doing that right now?
Because I'm totally doing it.
Are you going to use Afterpay?
Yeah, I'm totally doing it. Yeah. No, I'm not gonna put all my information in.
No, don't show your information. Just show the process, and then and then, you know.
We'll do it next time. I love the idea, though.
Let's not say we did. My mom used to say that to me all the time. That's funny. yeah, but Philip, they're fire. Those shoes.
Oh my gosh. They're so awesome. Like, you can't not see them. Like, you would see them from like a block away.
I expect you to show them off on the next office hours.
Yeah. Well, let's see how fast they can ship to me. By the way, if I could give a little plug for things I love StockX because they have a really awesome search. And they have, like, everybody in the world is using StockX. GOAT has they have higher prices because they have a better, just a more elevated service. When you're unboxing something and you're excited to open it, you open it and there's a shoebox inside. But when you open a shipment from GOAT, it's like the shoebox itself is wrapped in like vellum with a sticker from GOAT on it. And it's just like you open it and it's like, oh, this is luxury. This is like a luxury experience. I have to like break open this little seal. It's truly interesting. I think we lost Tony.
I think we did. It was his turn to say something he loved too. So I think he was like, oh, I don't love anything. I'm out.
that's okay. We can finish up with that.
Oh, he's back.
We lost you and then you're back.
And we're back, baby.
Okay. Tony, do you have something you love that you could?
I wasn't prepared to give something that I loved since I'm the host of this here program.
You don't love anything, do you, Tony? That's what we were just saying when you were gone.
You know what? You know what? I was thinking about it. I don't have like an application to go along with it, but you know what I love? And this is perfect for Valentine's Day. I love relationships. So one of my favorite things to do is to find a boutique shop and walk in and create a relationship with the person who's working there, who can be a strategic advisor in helping me choose out a look that's right for me. Because I'm a big fan of fashion, just like Philip's a big fan of footwear and buying the coolest shoes. I'm a big fan of buying, you know, the coolest jacket or the coolest pants or the coolest shirts or the shirts that fit best and so on. So, you know, I really love in-person interaction, and something like, you know, something like Zen chat or live chat where you can interact with someone who can give you advice. And I know that some of those applications are experimenting with video chat as well, with someone live in store. So if you go to, you know, quicksilver.com or something, and you want to buy a pair of board shorts, but you're not sure which ones to get, you can actually be connected to a store associate. I'm not saying that Quiksilver uses this, but this is something that I...
But you're not saying that Quiksilver...
Right. I have no idea. I have no idea if they are. I was just using it as an example because I worked at Quiksilver for 2.5 years, so it was top of mind.
No, Tony, what
this is something that's really interesting to me because I am all about like getting advice from people who know what they're talking about, who are in the industry. Just like, you know, if somebody was coming to us, you know, they would talk to Philip or Brian or anyone else at the Something Digital team as experts in the e-commerce space. I want to go in and I want to shop and I want to talk to someone who is an expert in whatever I'm planning to buy.
So what you're saying is, Tony, that for you, something that you love is when stores invest in their retail associates, mm-hmm. and train them to understand and know the product and hire people that they know are going to be interested and like love and get obsessed with that product. Absolutely. And then as a result, they invest back in you as the customer, AKA clienteling, which I think it's right on point. Philip and I have talked about this a lot, but this year and years to come, in retailers are going to be investing more and more in technology that allows their more trained retail associates to spend more time with their customers and provide them with a level of service that we have never seen before in retail.
Absolutely agreed. Absolutely agreed. And that's something that I'm looking forward to as e-commerce continues to evolve. Philip, anything to add?
I do have one more thing I love that I wanted to talk about, but
yeah,
do we have time for it?
Yeah, we have time.
All right, here we go. Okay. So I made I'm always going to have to go back to the Something Digital blog right now. Just cause that's my, sort of my hook into me being able to say, I've been talking about this for a long time. This is not new. So let's go to the Something Digital blog. Here we go. Come on a journey with me. Let's go down to e-commerce trends. Look at 2019. I wrote this. And if you check out the first trend, the thing that I say is super important, I say 2019 will be the year of guided commerce. And what do I mean by guided commerce? Basically, you know, something to the effect of, you know, like you've seen this in many ways, like quiz-based personality testing or questionnaires or chatbots that walk you through a decision tree. At the end of the day, customers are trying to find a product, right? And what we've been doing for many years in slice and dice, you know, e-commerce is we're just letting people, you know, We're basically sticking them on a category page with hundreds and maybe thousands of products and saying, here's a bunch of buttons, filter it, you know? And we treat every user like a power user, where when you walk into a store that has best in class service, they'll approach you and say, you know, who are you? I want to learn a little bit about you. What are you looking for today? You know, they want to guide you to the right product. They want to help you through their own experience. Find the thing that you're looking for. And I think that guided commerce is going to be the biggest trend of e-commerce in 2019. And guided commerce is actually kind of hard to build because it requires you, if you were going to build it from scratch, it requires you to build a whole, be an expert in UI, be an expert in sort of creating functional decision trees that make sense. Then you have to sort of be an expert in building some sort of mechanism to hook that up to all the products and all the decisions that might be made around the products. And even when you build it, then you've got to maintain that for the rest of your life, which, you know, is going to be that's also a challenge unto itself. So not a lot of brands that aren't, you know, top tier brands have been doing guided commerce well for some time. And then last year, I talked a lot on Future Commerce about brands that started doing guided commerce almost exclusively as their whole business selling model. And one was Care Of, which was like a vitamin company, which, you know, sort of changed its entire a sales approach to you to say, you know, you fit a persona. I want to help you find the right products for vitamins and supplements that I'm going to sell to you directly based on the way that you want me to interact with you. So if you're a skeptic around vitamins, I want all of our interaction to be around all the double blind case studies and FDA approvals that have gone into, you know, making health claims around supplements. Whereas if you're a true believer in supplements, I'm going to tell you about all the benefits that you're going to experience if you take these supplements. And I think that like was sort of transformational. So many brands are doing this now. We found a partner just like Siteimprove on the ADA side. We found a partner in the space who is doing this in a transformational way, and I want to introduce them to you right now. So there's a company called Zuvu. Zuvu is, which you may have, they've recently rebranded. They were called Smart Assistant for a little while. And they provide an actual guided commerce builder, which... Let's see if I can show you. I'm just going to have to go to live examples. I was on the live examples page. They basically create and power the guided commerce experiences for most of the major brands that you probably already interact with. So just if you need to just basically have your hand held a little bit as well, what is guided commerce? I can tell you, like, let's start at canon.co.uk. So I am looking for a lens for my Canon camera. This is why I should have pre-baked this. Let me use the shoe example. I feel like it's remembering me when I come back because I've already done this once before. Okay, great. So this is a great place to start. So I'm going to find the right, you know, trail running shoe for me. So the first question it asks is, I'm switching from another brand. I'm updating a pair of Mizunos I already have, or I want to start from scratch. So let's start from scratch. So next, I'm going to choose a men's shoe. I do a lot of trail running in real life. So we're going to choose a trail runner, and then I'm going to choose that I have a normal width shoe. Now you could, you know, somebody might say like, you could choose all this stuff in a layered navigation. But I'll explain to you why I feel like, you know, this is a better experience. So it says, find my shoe. And it actually makes a direct recommendation where I can read more information about the product, or, you know, some other sort of backup options that might also be right for me. What's really neat about this is that instead of me sort of just willy-nilly, let me go to the, I'm going to men, I'm going to running, and I'm going to find, can I even find trail running shoes in here? Who even knows? I'm already annoyed. And not only am I already annoyed trying to shop the old way, but I didn't know what I was looking for and they didn't learn anything about me. Whereas with this experience, with this guided commerce experience, they learned a lot about me by asking me 4 discrete questions. They learned my gender. They learned my shoe width. They learned how firm I like my shoes, and they learned that I like trail running. And guess what? Every email that I get from them from now on can be one-to-one targeted towards who I am, not what I browsed, but who I am as a customer. You can populate your CRM with this information. You can drive personalization on the website from it. All of my engagement, in fact, my PPC spend can be directly related to this because I'm going to make more targeted ads that are specific to this customer persona based on how I understand this customer. And, you know, if I wanted to get it even deeper, like, so this is just one example from their live examples. They have hundreds. You know, they've got a designer tool that basically allows you to create incredibly rich and complex guided commerce experiences. So of course the thing that I'm going to go for. You can do sort of the I know exactly specifically what I'm looking for experience, you can sort of start there. So, you know, I'm going to choose an aspirational bike that I can't afford. And I can, you know, customize the product directly, or I can see the stock bike. It can take me over to, you know, the stock bike example. It's a very expensive sort of a bike. So this could be an interesting, you know, just replacement for your existing category sort of slice and dice. But imagine if these, if they had, you know, made the bike family that's specifically around, well, what type of biking do you want to do? And that you can create these, the walkthrough doesn't have to be as, you know, as direct and personal. And that's what I like, is that these are still driven by the same technology, but they're completely polar opposite approaches to kind of arriving. Like, this is toward a power user, where the other one is I'm selling to a normal consumer. And so you can utilize Zuvu to drive all kinds of site experiences. And I think guided commerce is, you know, is the future. And you know, what's really interesting is you need partners to do stuff like this, because there is no e-commerce platform, Shopify or Magento, that build these experiences today. You know, so I'd expect that you would go on Zuvu and check out the live examples that they have, because they truly are cutting edge, and it gives the power to the merchant to drive that experience without having to engage engineers to build it out one time for them and then have to like manage that forever.
Yeah. Okay. My favorite merchants that do this are, I don't know if they're using Zuvu or not, but they're like wine clubs.
Yeah.
So they'll ask you, do you prefer a steak or popcorn or chocolate? And they'll give you a suggestion of wine after like eight questions. They'll give you a suggestion of wine that you might like. And, you know, if you subscribe to their, you know, allocation list or distribution list or whatever, then, you know, they'll send you a couple bottles of wine a month based on the selections that you made, which I think is really interesting. And I've seen it a few times, and I can't remember the sites that I saw it on, but I really love it. And then the classic example of this, again, I don't know if this is Zubu's, is Warby Parker.
Yeah.
And as someone who, like, for whatever reason, I have like a kind of unique face when it comes to sunglasses. I always have trouble finding good sunglasses, and actually Warby Parker doing their guided commerce quiz like helped me out a ton. And I found some good sunglasses, which I was pretty
proud. And the data points that you collect to help guide this, they don't always have to be as direct as you think. Like, you can use different, you know, it's not always just like face size. It's like, you know, style and thought and values and all of that plays into this. For instance, if we were to do, say, guided commerce for Leslie Knope, we could go look at her quote, which is, we have to remember what's important in life, friends, waffles, and work. Or waffles, friends, work, but work has to come third. Hence, this is the kind of data that you need. Like, for Leslie Knope, if she was going to go buy something today, it would either be something waffle related or something for her friends, and then work. And that's how she's going to spend her money. You need to know this data.
I love that you worked in a Galentine's Day Parks and Rec reference into that example. Just being, if you did nothing more, and you don't need Zuvu to do this, but if you did nothing more than ask every customer that comes to your website at least once a week or once a month when they return, are you shopping for yourself or are you shopping for someone else? It would make your data, making sense of your data, so much easier, because you'll be able to at least segment them from an analytics perspective, that they're who they're shopping for, and you can make much broader assumptions about who they are as people. And that's, you know, at the end of the day, what you're trying to do is give a better customer experience to everybody. And to do that, you need to understand who they are and what they're looking for. And guided commerce is one way to go do that. I think it's closer to what we would say is a best in class experience in real life. And I think that's what we're trying to model here when we build out websites for e-commerce. That's all I've got to say.
So we've run up on the end of our time here. So thank you, Philip, and thank you, Brian. Our next office hours is going to be on February 28th. We're really excited for that one. We also have a couple of Magento meetups coming up, one in South Florida and one I believe is going to happen in LA. Both, I believe, are going to be on March 14th, but we will keep you updated on the next edition, the 32nd edition, Magic Johnson. Everybody have a great time until then.
I'm going to say